the great sage has been in captivity for a long time," said the two deities. "And we had no knowledge of when you were released. That's why we have not been here to receive you, and we beg you to pardon us."
"All right," said Pilgrim. "I won't hit you.
But let me ask you something. Where did that monstrous dragon in the Eagle Grief Stream come from, and why did he devour my master's white horse? We have never known the great sage to have a master," the two deities said. "For you have always been a first-rank primordial immortal, who submits neither to heaven nor to earth. What do you mean by your master's horse?" Pilgrim said. "Of course you didn't know about this. Because of my contemptuous behavior toward heaven, I had to suffer for this 500 years. I was converted by the kindly persuasion of Bodhisattva Guanyin, who had the true monk from the Tang court rescue me. As his disciple, I was to follow him to the Western Heaven to seek scriptures from Buddha. We passed through this place, and my master's white horse was lost. So, that's how it is," said the two deities. "There has never been anything evil about this stream, except that it is both broad and deep, and its water is so clear that you can see right to the bottom. Large fowls such as crows or eagles are hesitant to fly over it. For when they see their own reflections in the clear water, they are prone to mistake them for other birds of their own flock, and throw themselves into the stream. Hence the name, the Steep Eagle Grief Stream. Some years ago, on her way to look for a scripture pilgrim, Bodhisattva Guanyin rescued a dragon and sent him here. He was told to wait for the scripture pilgrim, and was forbidden to do any evil or violence. Only when he is hungry is he permitted to come up to the banks to feed on birds or antelopes. How could he be so ignorant as to offend the great sage?" Pilgrim said. "At first, he wanted to have a contest of strength with me and managed only a few bouts. Afterwards, he would not come out even when I abused him. Only when I used the magic of overturning seas and rivers and stirred up the water did he appear again, and then he still wanted to fight. He really had no idea how heavy my rod was. When finally he couldn't hold out any longer, he changed himself into a water snake and wriggled into the grass. I rushed up there to look for him, but there was no trace of him. You may not know, great sage," said the local spirit, "that there are countless holes and crevices along these banks, through which the stream is connected with its many tributaries. The dragon could have crawled into any one of these. But there's no need for the great sage to get angry trying to look for him. If you want to capture this creature, all you need do is to ask Guan Shiying to come here. Then he'll certainly surrender." When Pilgrim heard this, he called the mountain god and the local spirit to go with him to see Tripitaka to give an account of what had happened. "If you need to send for the Bodhisattva," said Tripitaka, "when will you be able to return? How can this poor monk endure the cold and hunger?" He had hardly finished speaking when the golden-headed guardian called out from midair, "Great sage, you needn't leave. Your humble subject will go fetch the Bodhisattva." Pilgrim was very pleased, shouting, "Thanks for taking all that trouble. Go quickly." The guardian mounted the cloud swiftly and headed straight for South Sea. Pilgrim asked the mountain god and the local spirit to protect his master and the day sentinel to find some vegetarian food, while he himself went back to patrol the stream, and we shall say no more of that. We now tell you about the golden-headed guardian, who mounted the clouds and soon arrived at South Sea. Descending from the auspicious light, he went straight to the purple bamboo grove of the Potalaka mountain, where he asked the various deities in golden armor and mock-a to announce his arrival. The Bodhisattva said, "What have you come for? The Tang monk lost his horse at the Eagle Grief Stream of the Serpent Coil Mountain," said the guardian. "And the great sage son was placed in a terrible dilemma. He questioned the local deities, who claimed that a dragon sent by the Bodhisattva to that stream had eaten it. The great sage, therefore, sent me to request the Bodhisattva to go and subdue that cursed dragon, so that he might get back his horse." Hearing this, the Bodhisattva said, "That creature was originally the son of Auron of the Western Ocean.
because in his carelessness he set fire to the palace and destroyed the luminous pearls hanging there, his father accused him of subversion, and he was condemned to die by the heavenly tribunal. It was I who personally sought pardon from the Jade Emperor for him, so that he might serve as a means of transportation for the Tang monk. I can't understand how he could swallow the monk's horse instead. But if that's what happened, I'll have to get over there myself. The Bodhisattva left her lotus platform and went out of the divine cave. Mounting the auspicious luminosity with the guardian, she crossed the South Sea. We have a testimonial poem that says, Buddha proclaimed the Tripitaka supreme, which the goddess declared throughout Chang'an. Those great, wondrous truths could reach heaven and earth. Those wise, true words could save the spirits damned. They caused Gold Cicada to cast again his shell. They moved Shunzang to mend his ways anew. By blocking his path at Eagle Grief Stream, a dragon prince in horse form returns to the real. The Bodhisattva and the Guardian soon arrived at the Serpent Coil Mountain. They stopped the hallowed clouds in midair and saw Pilgrim Sun down below, shouting abuses at the bank of the stream. The Bodhisattva asked the Guardian to fetch him. Lowering his clouds, the Guardian went past Tripitaka and headed straight for the edge of the stream, saying to Pilgrim, "The Bodhisattva has arrived." When Pilgrim heard this, he jumped quickly into the air and yelled at her, "You, so-called teacher of the seven Buddhas and the founder of the faith of mercy. Why did you have to use your tricks to harm me? You impudent stableman, ignorant red buttocks," said the Bodhisattva. "I went to considerable effort to find a scripture pilgrim, whom I carefully instructed to save your life. Instead of thanking me, you are finding fault with me. You saved me all right," said Pilgrim. "If you truly wanted to deliver me, you should have allowed me to have a little fun with no strings attached. When you met me the other day above the ocean, you could have chastened me with a few words, telling me to serve the Tang monk with diligence, and that would have been enough. Why did you have to give him a flower cap, and have him deceive me into wearing it so that I would suffer? Now the fillet has taken root on old monkey's head. And you even taught him this so-called tight fillet spell, which he recites again and again, causing endless pain in my head. You haven't harmed me, indeed." The Bodhisattva laughed and said, "Oh, monkey. You are neither attentive to admonition nor willing to seek the fruit of truth. If you are not restrained like this, you'll probably mock the authority of heaven again without regard for good or ill. If you create troubles as you did before, who will be able to control you? It's only through this bit of adversity that you will be willing to enter our gate of yoga." "All right," said Pilgrim. "I'll consider the matter my hard luck. But why did you take that condemned dragon and send him here so that he could become a spirit and swallow my master's horse? It's your fault, you know, if you allow an evildoer to perpetrate his villainies some more. I went personally to plead with the Jade Emperor," said the Bodhisattva, "to have the dragon stationed here so that he could serve as a means of transportation for the scripture pilgrim. Those mortal horses from the land of the east, do you think that they could walk through 10,000 waters and 1,000 hills? How could they possibly hope to reach the spirit mountain, the land of Buddha? Only a dragon horse could make that journey. But right now he's so terribly afraid of me," said Pilgrim, "that he refuses to come out of his hiding place. What can we do?" The Bodhisattva said to the Guardian, "Go to the edge of the stream and say, 'Come out, Third Prince Jade Dragon of the Dragon King Aurung. The Bodhisattva from South Sea is here. He'll come out then.'" The Guardian went at once to the edge of the stream and called out twice. Churning the waters and leaping across the waves, the little dragon appeared and changed at once into the form of a man. He stepped on the clouds and rose up into the air. Saluting the Bodhisattva, he said, "I thank the Bodhisattva again for saving my life. I've waited here a long time, but I've heard no news of the scripture pilgrim." Pointing to Pilgrim, the Bodhisattva said, "Isn't he the eldest disciple of the scripture pilgrim?" When he saw him, the little dragon said, "Bodhisattva, he's my adversary. I was hungry yesterday and ate his horse. We fought over that, but he took advantage of his superior strength and defeated me. In fact, he so abused me that I dared not show myself again. But he has never mentioned a word about scripture seeking. You didn't bother to ask my name," said Pilgrim. "How did you expect me to tell you anything?" The little dragon said. "Didn't I ask you, what kind of a monster are you and where do you come from? But all you did was shout, 'Never mind where I come from. Just return my horse.' Since when did you utter even half the word Tang? That monkey," said the Bodhisattva, "is always relying on his own abilities. When has he ever given any credit to other people? When you set off this time, remember that there are others who will join you. So when they ask you, by all means mention first the matter of scripture seeking. They will submit to you without causing you further trouble." Pilgrim received this word of counsel amiably.